I have a Marine on the phone, J.J. Hanson. J.J., thank you for joining me on New Jersey 101.5. Good morning.
Good morning. Thank you for having me on.
You bet. Now, J.J., I want to just set this up so people understand your story. You were diagnosed in 2014. You served your country honorably in the Marine Corps. You were diagnosed in 2014 with terminal brain cancer.
That is correct. I was diagnosed with GBM. Grade 4 glioblastoma multiforme.
And you have made it a cause. Now, first of all, I understand that you were given just months to live. You've got a young wife. You've got a 2-year-old son, I believe, right? And you were given 6 months to live. You are now past a year.
Yeah, I actually was given initially, I was told that the brain tumors that I had were inoperable, that there was nothing I could do, that I should go home and enjoy the time that I had left. I was told at that point that I had 4 months left to live.
Wow.
And best case scenario, I may be able to get a year, but likely I had 4 months left to live. And that was about 18 months ago.
Can I ask you, JJ, what went through your mind when the doctor told you that?
Well, you know, it's just a life-altering situation for a lot of different reasons. When you have to really face your own mortality. For me, being a Marine who was in Iraq, it's kind of the second time that you have to really go through that process of taking a look at your life and saying this could be it. However, this time it was a little bit different because I was told not that you could die, but in fact that you are going to die. So when you have to go through that, you have to make a decision. You have to say, am I going to just give up and accept what they told me and give up the time that I have and go home, or am I going to try and fight this? Am I going to not listen to that initial diagnosis and go out there and try and say, I'm going to do everything I can to survive, whether it's a day, a week, a month, year, whatever you can get out of it.
Now, in that time, you've made it a case, and I'm going to ask you to hang with me because people need to hear your story. You are a national advocate, really, for opposition to this assisted suicide legislation that's legal in a few states now. Oregon, one of them. You had the same diagnosis as Brittany Maynard, who became essentially the face and the voice of the right to die movement. And there is pending legislation in New York and in New Jersey that I don't know that people really understand the opposition to, and I'm hoping you can shed some light on it, JJ, from your personal experience. If you can just hang with me for a minute, I have to take a quick break for traffic and weather, and then we'll come back. JJ was diagnosed in 2014 with terminal brain cancer. He's got a wife and a 2-year-old son, and he has spent the better part of the last year fighting against doctor-assisted suicide. Now, there are two bills pending, one in New Jersey, one in New York. And JJ, I wanted to get your input directly on this. This was the quote from the New Jersey State Senate President, Steve Sweeney, with regard to whether or not the right to die legislation will go through in New Jersey. And he said, quote, I'm a supporter of it. This is about dignity and respect at the end. It's not about suicide. It's not at all about suicide. It's about letting someone finish their life in a respectful way. That's the New Jersey State Senate President, Steve Sweeney. What's your answer to that as someone who is directly involved in this discussion?
You know, it's really an interesting statement, and it's something that the opposition of our organization, Patients' Rights Action Fund, it continues to put out there, and it's that if you don't agree with them, then you're undignified. That if you don't agree with their point of view, at some point, some way you don't have compassion, which is a misutilization of the words. And it's something that's fundamentally, in my opinion, and many of the supporters with us, is wrong. And for people that are similar to myself that have had a terminal diagnosis, similar to other people who have disabilities and people who want to fight for the way that they can exist in life, it puts them at a disadvantage. And it sets up this scenario that if you don't want to commit assisted suicide, if you don't want to have physician-assisted suicide, that somehow you are wrong. And that anyone who dies without that is going to be dying with a lack of dignity. And it's something that really is a narrative that they continue to push forward. For my own example and my own personal life, I had my grandmother who died in a hospital. And she died in a hospital. She was 82 years old. And she had enough time to get all of her grandkids there, 23 of us, except for one, who was overseas at the time with another Marine, and have all of her children there with her to die. Now, she did not commit assisted suicide. She did not have to take pills to end her life. And she had a very beautiful, dignified death. So this idea that if you don't support this, that somehow you're going to be undignified is absolutely incorrect.
What would you say, JJ, what would you say to the folks that say, well, that's your choice, but everyone else needs to make their own choices, and that's why we need the legislation?
Again, it's this misconception of what choice actually is. You know, someone who was in the service and who defended our ideal of independence. You know, I served in Iraq, and I understand it. I truly value it. Personal liberty, I think it's very important. However, and here's the big part. When my understanding or misperception of what choice is can end your life or can end your children's life by changing the social norm of the importance of insurance coverage, of clinical research for terminal diseases, when those things happen, it becomes the status quo within our society, that's a problem. When my choice can end up killing you, that is a serious problem, and it's a serious danger for our society, and it's something that most people don't understand about this issue. And it was something you said earlier, is, well, what is this issue? People think it's well, my grandmother or my mother or another one of my family members is in their 70s or 80s, and they only have 5 days left to live, and they're going to be in pain, and that's what they want. So why should I let them? Well, no, that's not what it is. This law will allow you to go to your doctor. If you have a six-month terminal diagnosis, which I had, they will review you. They will give you a set of pills that you could take that ultimately end your life at that point. You then go home. There's no follow-up.
Right.
No one's checking in on you. No one's seeing how you're doing.
And here you are, after that same diagnosis, more than a year later, fighting to live. JJ, I've got to get out now and get to news, but I really appreciate your time. I appreciate your cause. We're praying for you, because miracles do happen. And, you know, either way, you are on the right side of history. And what you're doing is incredibly courageous. I know that we've got you, your wife, and your son in our thoughts and prayers. Thank you, JJ.
Thank you so much.